Thank you for that. Good morning. It's good to be here again with you all. I feel like we haven't been in church in a long time, but we've actually been attending at City Church off and on because Noah was part of the Belize missions team, and so there were meetings and everything else. We needed to be there. So I don't just come to speak now like that's a new thing or something. But anyway, it's great to be here with you all this morning. I want to talk today about the resurrection. One thing that I think I touched on last time I spoke, and it's been kind of a theme, we're talking about taking to the streets, but there's a word called apologetics. Have we gone into that at all? Okay, has anybody heard of that word, apologetics? Now, what it doesn't mean is to go up to people and say, I'm very sorry. I'm a Christian. Can you be a Christian? I'm sorry. Apologizing. It's actually a legal term in the Greek. It comes from the term apologia. We find it in 1 Peter 3:15 when it says, always be prepared to give a defense for the hope that you have. It's the word defense. So in a court of law, the prosecution is making their defense, and the defense is making their case, right? So that's what apologetics is. It's a branch of theology that deals with making a case, either a positive case for Christianity or mounting a defense for those who would bring challenges or accusations. Now, apologetics does not save anyone. It gets a bad rap because it's often done academically by those in academics and philosophers and those who are in the academy. And so the claim is, well, you can't reason someone into the faith, and if you can argue them into the faith, then you can argue them out. And that's not what we're talking about. What we're looking at, and in my opinion, sharing the gospel, talking to people about Jesus, what we call evangelism, and apologetics are two sides of the same coin. Because the reality is there are tons of barriers and strongholds that people have in their lives, walls that are put up. And yes, it's the gospel that is the power of God unto salvation. It's the Holy Spirit that is working to plow up the ground so that they can receive the seed in the message of the gospel. Yes. But apologetics is an incredibly useful tool that helps smash into the wall and to make even just chip away a little bit at a time some of these arguments and some of these things that stand in the way of people really hearing the gospel. Someone described it as putting a pebble in someone's shoe. What do you do when you got a pebble in your shoe? You're always aware of it, right? And you got to either stop and address it, or you're trying to, you know, scrunch your toes so that it'll kind of get into a spot where it's not pressing right in on your foot, right? But it's there. And so evangelism and apologetic arguments help put pebbles in people's shoe. So when they walk away, they've got to think about and wrestle with a little bit what you've talked about. And so I don't think we need to be ashamed when we say that we believe in the resurrection. It doesn't mean that we think everyone rises from the dead. I went to a funeral this week. I had the privilege of officiating Jean's grandmother's funeral. I didn't expect her to rise from the dead. So my belief in the resurrection of Jesus from the dead does not mean that I'm so silly and so ignorant that I think, oh, dead people rise. Believe it or not, I've had people say that. Well, you Christians believe that people rise from the dead. No, we don't. We believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. That's a little bit different. So, with that being said, what I want to do today is I want to walk us through a way that we can sort of present and or defend the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, you can go to the next slide. A man and his wife, sorry, his ever-nagging wife, I know that's nobody here, went on vacation to Jerusalem. While they were there, the wife passed away. The undertaker told the husband, you can have her shipped home for $5,000, or you can bury her here in the Holy Land for $150. The man thought about it and told him he would just have her shipped home. The undertaker asked, why would you spend $5,000 to ship your wife home when it would be wonderful to be buried here, and you'd only spend 150. The man replied, long ago a man died here, was buried here. 3 days later, he rose from the dead. I just can't take that chance. Yeah. I didn't write this, so. Anyway, next, please. So, what we want to do is look at, what does the Scripture say about the resurrection? Paul says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And by the way, this passage of Scripture is the single best passage for the resurrection, looking at it from a historical standpoint, looking at the theological implications of the resurrection. We wouldn't get into it all today, but point out a few things. If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is also in vain. Moreover, we are found to be false witnesses of God, because we testified against God that he raised Christ, whom he did not actually raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. So not only if Christ hasn't risen from the dead, we're still in our sins, but then also there's no hope for a future resurrection. So this is why the resurrection is very important. Those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. Paul says we are pitied among men because we believe that somebody rose from the dead. But if he did not, in fact, rise from the dead, then what are we doing? Why do we get up on Sunday morning and come together and do this? We should be playing golf or fishing or doing something else with our time. The resurrection is the linchpin in which I think all of Christianity stands or falls. If you can prove the resurrection to be false, that it did not happen, then what are we doing? What are we believing in? Now, I know that comes with some qualifications, and maybe we can get into that another time, but this is how important the resurrection is. Jesus says this, the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us as your authority for doing these things? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, it took 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. So when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he said this, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had spoken. The resurrection was a validation. It was God's validation of the life and teaching of Jesus Christ. He raised him from the dead. Most of Jesus' miracles were an apologetic of the preaching and teaching of the kingdom of God that he brought. They were the signs, the wonders, the displays of power. They were more or less an apologetic validating the things that he was saying. So there's two approaches that I want to compare today as we look at this. There's the approach that would probably go really well in this church and any other church across the U.S., and that's the Bible reliability approach. The Bible reliability approach says this, Jesus rose from the dead because the Bible says so. And for most of us, that's good enough, right? The Bible says it, we believe it, that's it. It's settled for us. It says the Bible is inerrant. It says the Bible is reliable. Now, again, we believe all those things to be true. But if you go up to the average person, especially someone who's skeptic or skeptical, at least, about these things, they're not going to accept the Bible the same way that we are. Most people see it as a holy book, says some good things, at least the good things that Jesus says about peace and love and loving one another, or whatever it is they think the Bible says that fits their narrative, their lifestyle. But actually, they're not going to accept it as inerrant. They're not going to accept the Bible says it, therefore I believe it's true. So what do we do with that? I suggest another approach, the minimal facts approach. Now, this approach was developed by a man named Dr. Gary Habermas. He's the chair of philosophy at Liberty University. He did his PhD for Michigan State back in the 70s, and what he did is took a survey of over 1,500 biblical and New Testament scholars and historians. These are professional academics working in that field, from the way right, which would be, you know, evangelical or fundamentalist, even Christians, they're born again, they believe every single word written on the page without question, and all the way over to the far left of skeptics who hardly believe anything at all, okay? And he pooled all of what these 1,500 scholars or so generally agree to be historical fact from what Scripture says about Jesus and the resurrection, okay? So you have atheist, agnostic scholars. You have scholars who aren't necessarily antagonistic towards Christianity, but they're New Testament scholars. And then you have those who would be Bible-believing evangelical. And they all look at the same set of historical facts, and they're all coming to sort of different conclusions. So he took a list and he narrowed it down to, I think there's probably 25 to 30 that are pretty much universally accepted by all these scholars as having happened in history, of having a real solid base in history. Some of the real skeptical ones, they don't even believe that they believe anything about anything. So you're not going to convince them of anything, even their own skepticism. So what they do, though, this approach is treats the New Testament as an ancient historical document, right? We can all agree that the Bible was written centuries ago. It's an ancient historical document. If it's nothing else, it's at least an ancient historical document. And what we're doing is we're using only facts which are extremely well supported by the evidence. And facts which are accepted by the majority of critical scholars, even extreme skeptics. And this leads us to the five main facts, okay? Now, before we get to the five main facts, there are standards of historical credibility. So if you're a professional historian, when you come across an ancient document or something from the past, you're testing it. You're applying certain things to it to see if it's credible. And so they'll say, are there multiple independent sources for this testimony? Is it early? Is it close to the events that it's reporting about? Is it eyewitness? Is it enemy? Is there any enemy testimony about it? Or is it only from those who are favorable to it? And is there anything embarrassing in this testimony? And so we are limiting our case for the resurrection to five main facts that meet some or all of this historical criteria of credibility. Fact number one, and you'll see on your outline, I tried to leave room for writing. The reason I'm doing a PowerPoint and giving an outline like this is because there has been literally thousands of volumes written on the resurrection. So get comfortable. But there's a lot to cover, but I think this is really important to just get the basic framework down, and then we can always talk some more and fill it in a little bit more. we'll try to remember the acronym CEO-PJ. That can help us remember some of these main points. So the five historical facts that, again, pretty much every scholar agrees on is number one, the fact that Jesus died by crucifixion. There are, like I said, extreme skeptics out there who don't believe that Jesus even died. There's a hallucination theory that the disciples and others were experiencing such grief that they hallucinated seeing him alive. There's the twin Jesus theory that Jesus died and his body was thrown in an unknown, unmarked grave, probably eaten by dogs, but he had a twin. So the twin was walking around Jerusalem, and people thought, oh, that's Jesus. There's the swoon theory that Jesus was mostly dead, like Princess Bride, right? Mostly dead, but not quite. And so it wasn't actually a resurrection. There's all kinds of problems with those theories. But the scholars, those who work day in and day out and study these things, almost universally agree Jesus died by crucifixion. We have it in Christian sources. We have the four Gospels, which are not one source, but four separate sources. We have the book of Acts talks about it, and we have some of Paul's letters, like we're going to look at in Corinthians. That was actually written before any of the Gospels. And so it's a very, very early testimony. And Jesus' death reported much earlier. It meets some of our criteria, multiple independent testimony, early testimony, and embarrassing testimony. Next slide is secular sources. Josephus was a Jewish historian. He writes about the risen Jesus, the crucifixion of Jesus. Tacitus is a Roman historian. Lucian, all of these other guys, they're not Christian or even friendly to Christianity necessarily, but they're all writing about the fact of Jesus' crucifixion. And this is an interesting passage out of Tacitus. I don't know if you can see it or not, but Nero fastened the guilt of the burning of Rome and inflicted the most exquisite tortures on a class hated for their abominations, called Christians by the populace. Christus, from whom the name had its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius. The extreme penalty referred to the crucifixion. It was so nasty, they didn't actually even like using that term. But everyone knew when they would say extreme penalty that it meant crucifixion. And so here he's attesting to this Christus suffering the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius under Pontius Pilate. So it's actually confirming the testimony of the Gospels. And this is a completely secular source written right around A.D. 115. And so, go to the next slide. And I don't want to get too much into all this, but I want to point out there was a study by the Journal of American Medical Association, 1986, where they did a study looking at what the ancient historical documents talk about crucifixion, the way they describe it, and the way it was done. And they went through and they said, okay, what was actually happening during this crucifixion? Is it possible that Jesus wasn't really crucified? And so just going through some of this medical evidence, this was released in this journal, and it was very, very convincing that there was no way Jesus or anyone could have survived the brutality of the crucifixion. So I'm not going to read all this for you. I just left it up here for you to look at. And again, there's a lot of things out there that you can look through. The nailing of the wrists of the cross and some of the things that there's no way Jesus would have survived. Now, why does that matter? Why does it matter that Jesus actually physically died on the cross? Without a death, there's no resurrection. Right? It's something else, but it's not a resurrection. And Paul just told us in 1 Corinthians the importance of the resurrection. Later in that same passage in Corinthians, Paul talks about Jesus' resurrection being the first fruit of the resurrection for the rest of us. So not only is it that we worship and follow a risen Savior, we're actually placing our hope in the fact that that's going to be us too. We are going to be raised to life again. And that's a powerful truth. So if there's no crucifixion, there's no death, there's no resurrection. John Dominic Crossan, who I don't want to misspeak, he's not necessarily a friend of Christianity. I don't know that he's an atheist scholar, but I think he's agnostic. He says this, that he was crucified, Jesus was crucified, is as sure as anything historical can ever be. And that's a pretty powerful statement. Historians usually don't speak in absolutes because, you know, they weren't there. But they look at the evidence, they weigh it, they measure it, and they scrutinize it, and they say, we're pretty sure this is what took place. And so that's quite an admission for someone who's not an evangelical, you know, friend of Christianity necessarily, to make that sort of statement. So Jesus' death by crucifixion, that is one of the historical facts that is pretty much universally agreed upon. Fact number two, the empty tomb. This is where we're getting our E from in our CEOPJ acronym. The empty tomb, the fact of the empty tomb. Now, there are a lot of theories about that as well. One popular theory is that Jesus was tried as a criminal, and so he would have just been thrown into a common criminal's grave and probably eaten by dogs or wild animals like common criminals. So we don't really know where his body was. There's, you know, theories that the disciples took the body and hid it so that they would say, well, you know, the disciples would say, well, you can't produce the body, so he must have been risen. He must have, you know, raised again from the dead. But actually, we have very good reason to think that that's not the case, because Joseph of Arimathea was a Jewish religious leader, so people would have known him. They could ask him. They could go and see him and say, hey, did you let Jesus' body be put in your resting spot? They knew where that place would be, but yet the body wasn't there. There's three things to consider when we're looking at the empty tomb. Number one is the Jerusalem factor. It would have been impossible for Christianity to survive and expand in Jerusalem if the body was still in the tomb. You could go to the tomb, you could look, and you could see there's Jesus' body. He didn't rise again from the dead. And that's why theories like hallucination theory fail. Jesus is making the claim, you destroy this temple, and in 3 days it will rise again. He's talking about his physical body. It wasn't some sort of spiritual resurrection that you can't prove right or wrong one way or another. It'd be like me saying, well, I flew here today. Well, I didn't see you. Yeah, but you did not see me, right? I flew here. Instead, it would say, I drove here in a black truck that says Sims on the side. You could easily go outside, look, and see, not the nice one, that's Aaron's, the other one, and say, oh, yeah, there it is. There it is, right? You can quantify it. You can put it to the test. Someone is saying something, you can go and look and put it to the test. Jesus is saying, I will rise again in 3 days. And they're saying, yeah, right, prove it. He did. Jesus lived, taught, did his miracles, did everything in and around Jerusalem. He was crucified, he was tried, beaten, crucified, and buried in and around Jerusalem. He rose again from the dead, walked and talked and visited people in and around Jerusalem. So it wasn't like this was done in a far-off land or a spiritual resurrection where you could never see him again. No, this was done physically. He said, put my words to the test. I will physically rise again and you will see me. So the Jerusalem factor is powerful. The same people that he told them he was going to do this are the same people who would have been there to prove it wrong if it wouldn't have happened. But nevertheless, we don't have any historical document from the first century that proves or even challenges the theory that Jesus rose from the dead. It came later, 3rd, 4th century later. And that makes a big difference. Enemy attestation. Early polemics presuppose the empty tomb. Obviously, we have the Gospels, we have Justin Martyr, Tertullian, and other sources that, again, they're mocking and making fun of Christians' belief in the resurrection. And so they're acknowledging that the tomb is empty. No one's producing a body. The Roman soldiers were told to keep quiet about it. Don't tell anybody about it. Why would they say that? All they would have to do, all the Jewish leaders would have to do, or the Roman authorities would have to do, is produce a body. And they couldn't. All they'd have to do is go to the tomb, they knew where it was, and prove that he did not rise from the dead. We also have the testimony of women, which is incredibly powerful. Listen to this quote. "But not let the testimony of women be admitted on account of the levity and boldness of their sex. Not let servants be admitted to give testimony on account of the ignobility of their soul, since it is probable that they may not speak truth, either out of hope of gain or fear of punishment." Listen to this one. "Sooner let the words of the law be burnt than delivered to women." This was how women were viewed, and their testimony and their reliability was viewed back then. But what did the Gospels have? Women showing up at the tomb first. Women going back to tell the disciples, "Hey, he's not there anymore. He's risen from the dead." So if I was going to fabricate and write about a risen Savior during that time, I would not use the testimony of women. I would say, "Oh, Joseph of Arimathea and Pontius Pilate himself went down to the tomb and were blown away by seeing Jesus coming up out of the grave." In fact, we have a really fantastic account like that. I think it's in the Gospel of Peter, which is a Gnostic gospel that was written later. There's no truth to that. It's not connected to any sort of apostolic authority. The one that has apostolic authority is the one that has the testimony of women. Why would you put that in there unless you're simply reporting what happened? You're just trying to give an account of what happened. Jesus rose from the dead. Okay? So all three of those sort of help solidify the fact that the tomb was empty. There was certainly plenty of opportunity for them to show that that's not true. Fact number three, the origin of the Christian faith. The origin of the Christian faith. Now, if you turn to 1 Corinthians in chapter 15, verses 3 through 8, you see Paul saying, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to Scripture, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen away, or fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, to one untimely born, he appeared also to me." Now, this is a creed. This is written in a sort of creedal format. And I'm not going to pretend that I'm a Greek scholar, but as I understand it, when you read this in the original language, you can see that Paul, when he uses the terms "that Christ" and "that," he's reciting something that he's memorized. This happened, then this happened, then this happened. Creeds would have been memorized and passed around from believers to believers to believers in all the sort of different locations. You know, they didn't have the Bible to read from. And so they would have memorized these things. So it would have been in a form that they could easily commit to memory. And Paul's saying that right here. "I gave to you." So he'd already been to Corinth. He'd already shared with them. And remember, this predates the Gospels. So this is one of the earliest records we have of what the early church believed regarding the resurrection. And here we have eyewitnesses listed. And this was probably within, you know, what is the date of Corinthians? 50s-ish? 60s? So this was within probably 30 years, which for antiquity is nothing. It's no time. But Paul is passing this on. He'd already been to Corinth, and now he's writing them again. So he'd been to Corinth really early. But he's saying, look at white. What's written in white is definitely a part of the pre-Pauline creed. Again, biblical scholars, historians, they look at these things and they say, well, we're really confident this part, yes, this was definitely part of a pre-Pauline creed. The green, probably a part of it. And this part in black, this is Paul sort of expanding on it a little bit or explaining it. But the core of this creed has the theological implications of the resurrections. He died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried and he raised on the third day. That's showing that at a very, very, very early time in history, within years, a year or two of the events happening themselves, it was universally recognized in the church that we worship a risen Savior. This is important because there is an accusation that Jesus didn't actually see himself as divine. He didn't want to be worshipped, and he didn't teach resurrection, but that was invented later, that the church gained a little momentum and started to invent these things and attach deity to Jesus and attach resurrection to Jesus. But actually, this proves that wrong, because this is one of the earliest creeds that we have of the church. So we can see from the very, very beginning, they believed in the risen Savior. And then Paul, he's listing people. So what's that mean? That means I could go and I could ask Peter. I could ask the 12. And in fact, let me go to the next slide. How do we know it's a creed? Again, the Paul's passing on tradition, I delivered, I received, that was a very common way of passing things on among the churches. The word use of the word that is very common in the creeds. Again, the content is stylized, containing parallelisms. It just, the way in the original language, it's the way it would have read. Dun, 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 you know, would have had a flow to it, maybe like a song or a poem or something that would have been easy to commit to memory. Non-Pauline terms is, again, theologians will look through and they'll look through all of Paul's writings and they'll recognize themes and ideas and words that Paul uses over and over again to identify how he writes and what he's saying. And what is contained in this portion of 1 Corinthians is some non-Pauline terms. When did he receive this? And here's what's really important. We have, let's date the crucifixion of Jesus around 30 AD, okay, give or take a couple years. Paul's conversion right around AD 32. He went to Jerusalem on a fact-finding mission. He talks about this in Galatians. He went to meet with Peter. And again, some of the words there that are used give us the idea that Paul went there to interview Peter like a reporter or journalist does. Paul's saying, hey, this is what I understand in my conversion. And he's talking with Peter. He's interviewing him. And this happened AD 35. So you can see within 5 years, Paul is getting this creed. So the belief in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and the origin of the Christian church is built on this belief in the resurrection. It couldn't have waited till centuries later because there would not have been a church anyway. It was based on the resurrection of Jesus Christ, physical resurrection of Jesus from the dead. So, next slide. Trip to Corinth in 51. I don't want to get too much into all this, except to say atheist New Testament scholar Gerd Ludemann, he even dates the creed between 32 and 33. So that's a very favorable dating for that. And again, this is important because it establishes that from the very beginning, Larry Hurtado, one of the top scholars in the New Testament, he says this, there was never a time when the New Testament church did not preach Jesus' deity and resurrection. So that is at the core of Christian belief, from the very beginning, the risen Savior. Why would that be unless that's what actually happened? right? It couldn't have developed centuries later. The church wouldn't have even existed unless that was at the core. The summary of the creed: we have early testimony to Jesus' resurrection appearances, we have eyewitness testimony to his resurrection appearances, multiple testimonies, Cephas, the 12, more than 500, all the apostles, James, and Paul. And so, again, listing names, listing people that could be interviewed, that you could go and see, did this actually really happen to you? The 500, it couldn't have been a mass hallucination, because if all of us in this room had a mass hallucination, we would all see different things. We wouldn't all see the same thing. And so how do you explain that? I'm going to skip this one because it ties into fact 4 and 5. This, to me, these two are very, very powerful, very convincing. But you have the transformation of Paul, the church persecutor. His conversion. We all know what happened to him on the Damascus Road, right? Bright lights, someone appeared to him, said, "Why are you persecuting me? Why are you doing these things to me?" And then he went and his eyes were open. He realized it was Jesus, and all of these things. Paul talks about that in 1 Corinthians and in Galatians. It's recorded in Acts chapter 9. Something happened to Paul. Something happened to him that changed him from a hater of the church, a persecutor of the church, one who would seek out the church to destroy it and to murder and to martyr them. And now all of a sudden, he's getting martyred eventually for that faith. What happened that is so powerful that took him from Saul the persecutor to Paul the apostle and the author of, 13 of 27 New Testament books? Something happened. And it had to be more than just some hallucination or some religious experience. Those are powerful. But I would suggest that him experiencing the risen Savior on the road to Damascus, a physical being, person, Jesus, would probably do it. I mean, you have to at least make sense of this. What is the best explanation for this fact? Well, I think the best explanation is the most obvious one. Paul experienced the risen Christ, tangibly, physically experienced him, and it changed him. Next one. We see something similar with James, the brother of Jesus. He was a skeptic. And Mark, and it also recorded in John, he wasn't much of a believer in Jesus. James wasn't. There's an episode, I think, where basically he says, "Jesus, you're out of your mind. Come on, you're embarrassing the family," I think, more or less. Loose paraphrase. But it's clear he's not a follower of Jesus. But then all of a sudden, he becomes the founder of the head of the church in Jerusalem. What happened? He saw the risen Jesus. His name is listed in the names of people that Paul wrote as Jesus appearing to. So him experiencing the risen Jesus was enough to get him on board. He became the church leader. He suffered and was martyred. Liars make poor martyrs. Have you ever heard that expression? Liars make poor martyrs. All these guys would have had to do was deny the resurrection. But they could not deny what they know to be true. Now, we have martyrs today who die for their faith, what they think is true, what they believe is true, but not what they know to be a lie. You see the difference? These guys knew if this was a lie or not. They knew it was true. And so they didn't have to lie about it. They stood by their conviction because they understood the truth. And they experienced the risen Savior. Next one. So a summary of our facts. Jesus died by crucifixion, C. Jesus' tomb was found empty, that's E. And that's where we have the Jerusalem factor. We have enemy attestation. And we have the testimony of women, which wasn't valued at all, supporting the empty tomb. We have the origin of the Christian faith. Jesus' disciples were transformed. They sincerely believed he rose from the dead and appeared to them. Then we have the conversion of Paul and the conversion of James. We have C-E-O-P-J. Remember, when we're testing any claim, we want to look at it and say, does it have multiple independent sources of testimony? Are they early? Are they eyewitness? Are they embarrassing testimony? And then with anything, especially historical or something that we weren't around for, we want to ask, okay, here are the facts. Scientists do this all the time. They look at the facts or the experiment and they, you know, the outcome. Now, what is the best explanation for why we have C? We did A, B, now we have C. What is the best explanation for it? And you fit different theories, different hypotheses. What's plural of hypothesis? Hypotheses? Anyway, ideas as to why this is the way that it is. And so Jesus rose from the dead, I think, is the most obvious and the best explanation given the facts that we just looked at. And here's the conclusion. We can say, when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Paul believes so much in the resurrection as a fact that he's sort of mocking this idea of death. Is that all you got, death? Is that the best you can do? Well, yeah, when we hope in Christ and we put our faith and trust in Christ, his resurrection being the first fruits of what's to come, death, where's your victory? You don't have anything on me. The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain. Is there another one? No, okay. This is another similar approach. So what was the point of all this today? I mean, ton of information. And I know I went fast. But what I wanted to show is that it's the Spirit of God that convinces men of sin, judgment, and righteousness. It's the Spirit of God that brings revelation, that we are able to then see our need for a Savior. We're able to receive what Christ has done for us and be born again. There's no dispute there, no argument. But sometimes we feel like, man, what if someone asks me a question I can't answer? Or if you think about it, Jesus made a statement, you know, eat my flesh and drink my blood, and people are like, what? And they walked away. But yet, for us, who are in a church setting, in our bubble, we understand that, and that language doesn't scare us. But out in the world, people are like, well, that's weird. We believe that the Holy Spirit gives gifts that manifest different ways. That's weird. We put our faith and our hope in a guy who was raised from the dead after being dead for 3 days. That's weird. And so we might be hesitant to share that. Do you actually really believe in the resurrection? Well, I kind of have to if I'm a Christian. I say yes, absolutely, 100%. You want to know why? Let's look at it historically. And then let's try to understand the theological implications of that. So Is this going to bring someone to Christ? Probably not. Is it going to remove a barrier potentially? Absolutely. And that's all we're called to do, is put a pebble in someone's shoe so that the next encounter they have and the next encounter they have and the next encounter they have moves them further along and closer to Jesus. And so my goal today was to do a couple things. Number one, to show us how we can apply apologetics to the effort of evangelism. Apologetics builds our faith, but then it also helps us reason through why we believe what we believe with people. It helps us, helps make sense of some of those things. Secondly, it's so rich in truths for us to hear about Christ's victory over death and the benefit to us as believers. So I wanted to encourage us with that as well. But I also wanted us to see the methodology that we can apply to using reason and building it with reason and the use of the Spirit as the foundation of our faith that we can build upon. We believe, we have good reason to believe what we believe. There's a long, long tradition of Christian scholarship. People have been wrestling with these things for centuries. And so don't ever shy away from questions and challenges to the faith. Maybe you don't know exactly off the top of your head, but I guarantee somebody does. It's out there. And so be encouraged. We believe in a risen Savior, and we have good reason to do so. Do you want me to pray, or you pray, or pray? Okay. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we could be here today as your people. I simply ask, Holy Spirit, that you would open our eyes and our hearts to the truth of your word. Empower us with boldness to share the gospel as we ought to. We wouldn't shy away. We wouldn't shrink back. Help us not to rely on the arguments of men, but to understand that you've given us the ability to reason and think and to wrestle with these things. And actually, you take pleasure in us using our intellect and our mental capacities to think through these things in depth. Give us the words to say as we share with other people. Thank you for your work in our lives. Thank you for the work you did on the cross and rising again from the dead. In Jesus' name.